guys, how's everybody doing today? Welcome back to the channel. My name's Tara, this is Sheldon, and you're watching whatever this is called. And we're going to talk about Midnight's Kiss, which is Hulu Into the Dark Season 2's New Year's Eve special.
Yes.
This was directed by Carter Smith and stars Scott Evans and Adam Faison, I believe it's pronounced.
I do believe this is pronounced.
Yeah. So this one, this one's a disappointment, sadly. I saw the trailer. I saw the trailer, and it gave me generic revenge slasher vibes, and that is exactly what I wanted it to be.
Absolutely.
I just wanted a run-of-the-mill slasher set on New Year's Eve, because sometimes that's all you need. However, this about halfway through, maybe three quarters, not even.
It lost both of us.
It lost us. Yeah. It completely lost us. Like, we started off with a real great kill, and then later on, the cold open kill.
Yes.
Was a real good one.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was like, mystery, 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 who's it going
to be?
And then there's the first big death, which was spectacular. And then it fizzles off and gets really, really convoluted and confusing,
and the thing about
needlessly so.
After that kill, it just lost us.
Yep,
it lost me.
Completely lost us.
So.
Like, they do go to a club. Now, I had imagined that this whole thing was going to culminate in this club, in this big New Year's Eve party, because that's what it seemed like, right?
Yes.
But no, that's just the middle part. I don't, do anybody die in the club? No?
Honestly, I can't remember, but I don't think.
No. They're just, yeah. No, nobody dies. I'm trying to think, but nobody dies in the club scene.
No.
Which is where I thought most of the carnage was going to go down. I thought it was going to be this big party. Like, there's parts in it where you see they split off into, like, their own little groups. Mm-hmm. They all split up at the club. Like, oh, here we go. One by one. Here we go. Nope. We go back to the house, and that's where that supposedly happens. But then they start throwing red herrings at us left and right, to the point where you guess the killer. Because there's so many red herrings that you're like, well, what the fuck is this guy?
Exactly.
Like
eventually you figure out who the killer is.
And a character leaves, because he's mad at his boyfriend.
Yeah.
Comes back, and suddenly knows that everybody's dead, even though he just come back, and he's all panicking because everybody's dead.
That's when
I clued in, like,
yeah, right away.
How does he know everybody's dead?
I clued in too, and that's where we clue in stuff like that. But
like, how does he know everybody's dead if
he
didn't kill them?
And
then there is one death that is caused by someone else in the cast, and even that is not fully resolved to my satisfaction. Like, there's too many loose ends. The kills got real good at the beginning, and they fizzled off and fizzled off to the point where there's only four kills in this whole thing.
It gives me a feeling that the director, he wanted, after that kill, he's like, okay, that's it, we're done.
No, it's more like he wanted too many movies to happen at once.
He was doing too much.
He wanted the revenge killing, he wanted the obsession type situation. He wanted the friggin' jealous ex-boyfriend, and he wanted all these movies to happen, and then none of them happened. This needed a way bigger body count. I thought we were going into this, like, the trailer had Valentine feels, which, look out for that one, because that's on our list for next month. We're doing Valentine's Day next month.
And actually, I'm excited for that.
I'm excited for that, too, because Valentine is one of my favorite slashers, and I'm very excited to watch that for the channel.
But
I expected something like that.
Yeah,
because that ends at the party, the Valentine's Day party. Like, that makes sense.
Like, when you went to the club, it was like, okay,
here we go. Let's go. Carnage. Everything's beautiful. Bright. Like, it's a great-looking movie.
Oh, absolutely.
And they are acting their little arses off.
Mm-hmm.
They really are. But, like, so that's the basis of why we don't like it. Now I'm going to get a little bit more specific, so if you don't want spoilers, click off now. If you do, I don't see the reason of going out of your way to go watch this. I really don't.
It's not really
So, spoilers. The killer, they have this game called Midnight Kiss. That's the biggest part of it. And even if they're paired off in their pairs, now this is just a warning, because, you know, not everybody's okay with it. I am part of this group of people, but this is a gay movie. if you don't like seeing a gay man have sex, you should not watch this movie. But I think we're all over that by now. It's 2023.
It's time to evolve.
So you will see man ass. There will be a lot of man ass. There's going to be a lot of very flamboyantly queer characters. Mm-hmm. Like, some of them are a little over the top, but again, not all of them. Some of them are a little over the top queer, which is fine because I know over the top queers.
Right? Like,
I have many. I am kind of an over the top queer sometimes, but they have this game because they're such a close knit friend group that they've all slept with each other. On New Year's Eve, they find another person, just anybody, and they have to get that person to be their New Year's Eve kiss. That's the thing. That's their midnight kiss, and it's up to them. They have free reign for the rest of the night. Even if they're in a relationship, they can branch off and be with this person.
Exactly.
Like, it's a free pass New Year's Eve. It's like that limbo between New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, where nothing, time doesn't exist. Okay, if that's what you want to do, all consenting parties, fantastic. Remember the word consenting. Okay, because we're going to get into Joel. But anyway, so they show us this New Year's Eve back in 2013, where our main character, whose name is Cam, because I wrote it down this time, I'm smart. Cam is our main character. He kisses this boy. He decides he doesn't want any more, so, you know, he kisses this boy and goes about his merry way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, whatever. Apparently this boy...
Not offended. Not at all.
The opposite. He falls in love with him.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
From this kiss. To the point that he does everything to get him to notice him. It's an obsession thing. He becomes obsessed with this character after one evening and one kiss. And it has something to do with him being in the closet and he was, like, afraid to be gay and he was so open. Like, fine, yeah, okay, been there. But it was one kiss.
It was just one kiss one and kiss. He walked away. Cam walked away. And
the killer was so obsessed with him that years, it was like 5 years later or something?
Yes.
That he infiltrated the group, because it's one of them. He infiltrated the group and is now killing them. This is... So, if you don't want spoilers, the killer is Logan, the best character in the fucking movie.
Because he comes off as
he's sweet, kind. I got his description as golden retriever.
Mm-hmm.
He's just this floppy haired boy and he's so friendly and so kind and sweet and funny and he just wants everybody to have a good time and he wants to be part of the group so bad. And this is Joel's boyfriend.
Oh, here we go.
Joel, I have controlling prick wrote down. Joel has issues.
Oh, big time.
Joel is a control freak. If he doesn't control every second of everything, he has meltdowns. He needs help. He is very, very bad to Logan.
Mm-hmm.
Joel is also Cam's ex.
Yes.
And Cam very much loved Joel, but Joel treated him like shit. And he left Joel for treating him like shit. And now he sees him treating Logan like shit. And it makes him feel worse all over again. Like, you know, get out of there, dude. Red flags everywhere. Like... Logan makes a playlist, Logan wanted to play his playlist.
And
I made us a playlist. Like, and Joel's like, no, my friends won't like your music. Yeah, no, but I love your music, but they won't like it. So no, don't put your music out. I was like, well, why not?
Tell me you're control freak, but I tell you you're control freak.
Like, this guy's an asshole. And like I say about consenting, Joel wants to play this game again. And Logan agrees. He's like, okay, we're going to play, even though me and you are engaged to be married. We're going to have this night apart, consenting, perfect. That was fine. It's the fact that they all do Molly at one point at the club, and Logan says no, he doesn't want it, and Joel literally puts it on his finger and forces it into Logan's mouth.
Yeah.
And then Logan goes off, high as fuck, after doing Molly probably for the first time, not knowing anything's going on, gets with two guys at the same time, invites more, because he's on drugs, who his partner forced onto him and then told him that he has free reign for the rest of the night, that everything's okay, but then gets mad about it after. Oh, I got so mad.
Oh, that is the worst.
I hate Joel so much.
Like...
And Joel is one of our red herrings, who's not actually a red herring.
Mm-mm.
Because our boy Cam finds a nice little gay man. What was his name? I didn't write his name
down.
Dante. Oh, he was so sweet.
He was.
And they were so cute.
Mm-hmm.
No. No. He comes... Oh, dog's gonna bark because the dog barked outside. he comes back to the house with them. They go to do their thing, but they don't have condoms, whatever. And while Cam has gone looking for condoms, in a jealous rage, Joe kills Dante. And this is supposed to be a red herring, but I figured that out on a, like, during this whole thing, the killer is wearing a mask. He's not wearing a mask when he kills Dante. I was like, no, this is a one-time thing.
Clearly, you can see it, there's plenty of sight.
This is not resolved.
No.
It is, but it's not.
No, it's not.
We find out the killer's Logan, and we defeat the bad guy, but he says something. He says to Cam, ask him about your Pisces, little Pisces boyfriend or something. Because they were chit-chatting.
Yeah.
And that tips Cam off that it wasn't Logan that killed Dante, it was Joel. But why does that tip him off? Just because he was out listening in the bushes to the two of them talking, because doesn't mean that Joel was there. What does that have to do with Joel?
Right. Like, Logan,
Joel doesn't even know that he's a Pisces. No, what does
Logan
that mean?
Logan was the one that was...
that said Pisces and all this stuff. He was the one stalking them. Joel was in the house looking out the window. He didn't hear none of this, so... But anyway, this tips Cam off that it was actually Joel that killed Dante, and that's all there is to it. They're stood across from each other, and Joel's like, you know, this night has shown me how much I took you for granted and all this stuff, and he's like, no, I think you killed my new boyfriend that I just met at the club tonight, but hey, you know, they were cute. He was one of the most decent characters in this.
Absolutely.
And Joel stood there, and Cam walks off screen and joins our other final girl, Hannah, who is the only female and the only straight character, which, why though? But okay.
Anyway.
goes off, joins her. We don't know what happened to Joel. Is he still there just waiting for the cops to show up?
That's what I was wondering too, like...
Okay, Cam knows Joel killed Dante. What's Cam gonna do about it? Did he kill Joel and we just didn't see it? I don't know. This movie lost me. This needed more of a body count. This needed more gore and more just excitement. It got so boring. So boring.
Because I was like sitting down and watching it, like, and I was just about to ask you, I was like, are you losing as much interest as I am?
And it's like, I love me a good slasher. And I love me some queer horror. Yes, please. Because, you know, being seen is a thing. What am I trying to say? Inclusivity is a thing. Validation is a thing. I love queer horror. I love seeing a reflection of myself in the camera. But this failed on all parts because it felt almost too stereotypically queer.
Mm-hmm.
It almost felt too boring to be a slasher.
Yeah.
It was confused as all hell as to what it wanted to do. So that's my thoughts on it.
I don't have any thoughts on it because, like I said, I just lost interest in after half of it, and it's just not really worth watching it. That's just my opinion on it.
So our favorite kills, to get that out of the way. Oh, we didn't even talk about Zach.
Oh,
our lovely Zach.
Oh my God.
Our queen. Because that's the other two characters. There's Zach and there's Hannah.
Yeah.
Hannah is the straight girl that hangs out with all the gay men, which, why she gotta be straight? Or why do they all have to be gay? I don't understand
this.
Like, it's kind of playing up on the stereotype of the girl best friend. Like,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
the
absolutely.
Straight best friend, the girl best friend. But she's there. She's cool. I like her, to a degree. She enables Joel's behavior, which I don't like. She's like, oh, yeah, that's just the way it is. Like, no, bitch.
No. No, that's not how you do it. Like.
No. You cut that off. If you see your friend acting like that toward their significant other and saying shit like that to them, no. You see someone forcing drugs down their partner's throat? No. Like, you say shit about that. That's not right. But our other character is Zach. He's not in it much. Or no, they go by she.
Yes.
She's not in it much. Zach is our queen. Zach is our flamboyant, over-the-top queer boy who loves being queer. And I love him. He's fun. He's sassy. Like, it is stereotypical, yes. But, like, I also have friends like that.
Yes, exactly.
Like, I know these people. So Zach is our hustle, our first kill at the party, like the actual house, and the best kill in the entire movie, because when I saw Zach die, it was so graphic and glorious and cringy that I was like, is this what we're doing? Because this is what we're doing.
That's
I'm
where me and you got our interest, like...
Yeah, this is when we got excited. And then we went to the party. And then...
It just
we left
down,
the party.
It went down.
And nothing happened. Nope. It just turned into a weird episode of Queer as Folk. Like, it really did. If you've watched Queer as Folk, it turns into a weird episode of that. You probably don't even know about that. No. But it really did. It turns into, like, just a weird drama between this group of friends. But Zach goes into a closet, which he gets killed in the closet. Mm-hmm, the queerest one of them all.
Like,
he gets
really?
Killed in the closet.
Yeah.
He gets... he's being choked, and he kind of likes it. Because the dude is in, like, a bondage outfit with, like, a dog mask. It's mm-hmm. really kind of creepy and yep. really funny at the same time. It reminds me of American Horror Story, but with, like, puppy dog ears.
Right.
It's really funny.
But...
So he thinks it's, like, one of them trying to get an omelet and type thing. No.
No.
He ends up... They have these champagne bottles. And he doesn't just shove it down his throat. He breaks the neck of it. And then shoves it down his throat. And then breaks the bottle down his throat. And I'm like, we're good. If there's gonna be more of this, we're good. But there's... After that, one guy gets strangled. And another one gets shot in the gut, but first gets a needle full of poison stuck, like, next to their eye, which is really cringy, but That's it. The first guy in the cold open type thing gets a slow trash, which is a really good effect.
It is.
It looks great, and it comes back later on, where we see a video of him actually dying and the blood and everything.
Yeah.
It's a good effect. Very good, nasty death, but our favorite one was Zach
was
with the bottle,
Zach,
because that was
that
the
was...
most interesting one in it, and I was hoping for more of that,
the
but
other
it didn't
ones
happen.
Were just your typical...
It was just generic.
Yep.
Throat slash, strangle, shot. That's it.
That's it.
Well, poison next to the eye was a little cringy. You really didn't like this. You gave it a 5.
I gave it 5.
It was kind of a meh. I gave it a 6 just because I like slashers, and it was really pretty to look at. But, man, it was boring. That's, like I said, that's my biggest sin, is if something can't keep my attention, sorry.
You want to watch it? Watch it.
Yeah, watch it if you want to, but, nah, not a recommendation from us. So, yeah. That's it for today. I will see you Friday for Forgotten Films. I don't know what we're going to be at that. Obviously, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see you Tuesday for the,
Top
Tuesday.
Redo?
Redo?
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll get it there. For the extension of Tuesday Top Tuesday. We'll call it that, okay?
Okay.
And we'll see you next Tuesday together. Okay, bye!
Bye!